This video was made possible through the support of my patrons.
The most precious thing on this earth is the human brain, and yet we allow it to die.
It is quite useless to resist, as we are stronger and more efficient than your earth people.
You belong to us. You shall be like us.
The ascension shall begin.
The strength and might of the cyber race will be confirmed.
Pain. I am Vanguard. Pain.
Series 2 of the revived version of Doctor Who was make or break time. Yeah, the show had come back to a huge audience and a legion of dedicated fans, but showrunner Russell T. Davis and the rest of the creative team, including a brand new 10th Doctor, had to prove that lightning could strike twice. With Series 1, the iconic Daleks had been revised and redesigned for a new millennium, and with Series 2, it was time to do that with another recurring villain, and who better than the Cybermen. And with the Daleks in Series 1 taking inspiration from the Wilderness Years, with Dalek being adapted from the Big Finish story Jubilee, the two-part story Rise of the Cybermen and the Age of Steel took inspiration from Mark Platt's Spare Parts, though not quite as overtly, even though Platt does get a thank you credit at the end of the story. The Cybermen weren't the only returning elements, as behind the camera, we also have director Graham Harper, who directed the classic era stories The Caves of Androzani and Revelation of the Daleks, and this story sees the return of characters like Pete Tyler, but before we can move on to all of that stuff, let me back up. The 10th Doctor, played by David Tennant, is happily travelling through time and space with companions Rose Tyler, played by Billy Piper, and her boyfriend Mickey Smith, played by Noel Clarke, when suddenly the time vortex just disappears, and they plunge into a parallel world. They land in present-day alternative London, which has still living relatives of Rose and Mickey, as well as a different communications infrastructure, Cybus Industries, run by the terminally ill John Lumick, played by Roger Lloyd Pack. However, Lumick has bigger plans for England, and his company is kidnapping homeless people off the streets to be given the ultimate upgrade, removing the brain, ridding it of all emotions and pain, and implanting it into a suit of armour. The Cybermen. Now, when talking about Rise of the Cybermen and the Age of Steel, I need to be fair and consider that this story does not just exist as a standalone story. I wouldn't be surprised if there were a lot of mandates in place for writer Tom McRae, as this two-parter needed to set up the parallel world to set up for the series finale, Pete Tyler, the Cybermen, the temporary departure of Mickey, establishing supporting characters, and more. There's a lot of setup that this story needs to do, and in terms of the logistics and balancing those plot points and everything it needs to for the series finale, it does an admirable job. However, in setting up all of those pieces, I think it ends up making this story feel a bit neglected. The reason I feel this way is because the Cybermen themselves are absolutely terrific. Now, there is absolutely an argument to be made that making them look the way they do eliminates any sort of human characteristics. However, we need to remember that these are not desperate, surviving Mondasians. These guys were created in a well-stocked and well-equipped factory, and the ends here justify the means. The Cybermen have truly arrived in the 21st century. The days of tripping downstairs and the shouting of "Excellent!" are long gone, replaced with silver, metal, marching monstrosities which truly feel heavy and powerful. The stomping in unison is so effective, so scary, and immediately sells the idea of this mass uniform army. Also, it's pure playground fodder. You can imagine kids at school the Monday after this episode just stomping around, threatening to upgrade their teachers. Design-wise, I love them. Behavior-wise, I love them as well. They're gorgeously shot, amazingly presented. The Cybermen have arrived into this century, but it's the story surrounding the Cybermen that I feel lets them down somewhat. But let's talk about this parallel world first. Oh, I'm such a tease. So the Doctor, Rose and Mickey have landed in a world where Pete Tyler is not only alive and well, but he's a successful businessman whose healthy drinks and tonics not only landed him and his family into a massive estate, but also political influence. However, Jackie Tyler is a vain, self-obsessed diva, and the two did not have any children. By the way, I love how this Rose reveal is played, with Jackie shouting upstairs to Rose and the audience and just waiting for the reveal. Like, is Billy Piper going to play an alternative Rose? Is this Rose younger, older, massively different? Instead...
Oh, God's sake, where is she? Rose! Oh, she needs a good bath before tonight. She's going to be honking. Rose, come to Mummy! Come on! Oh, there you are, my darling!
I love this. And so does the Tenth Doctor.
Rose! It's my little girl! Come to Mummy! Come to Mummy! Yes! Good girl! Good girl, aren't you?
Although, speaking of the Doctor, I don't like how immediately confrontational he is about how Rose views this world. Like, last season, he went with Rose to the 1980s and watched her dad die in a hit and run. He knows how much his loss has informed who she is, but he's immediately shouting, immediately confrontational. Now, to be fair, the Doctor is a Time Lord, so maybe the idea of a parallel world is inherently alien and off-putting to him. He's prejudiced. But they landed 30 seconds ago, and the Doctor has gone from 0 to 10 in a way that makes him very unlikable. He seems very controlling. It also makes the supposed difference between how the Doctor treats Rose and Mickey not hit as hard. Maybe the Doctor could have been understanding and reasonable towards Rose, but later, when Mickey's gingerbread house gets ignored, it can mean something.
I told you to keep an eye on her.
She's alright.
She goes wandering off. Parallel world, it's like a gingerbread house. All those temptations calling her.
Oh, so it's just Rose then, nothing out there to tempt me.
Well, I don't know, I can't worry about everything.
Now, this subplot works well because A, it does come back in an effective way with loose ends tied up in Doomsday, and B, because of how well Billy Piper plays it. You can feel Rose's isolation and curiosity in this story, but we also can't ignore Noel Clark as Mickey, but more on him later. Sorry to be so annoying and pushing things further back, but there is a reason why I'm holding back on all of these subjects. Trust me on this. Trust me on this. Trust me on this. The subplot also gets a pretty powerful resolution when Jackie Tyler ends up getting converted off-screen into a Cyberman, and I love this shot where Pete and Rose get taken away and they look back to try and find Jackie, only for her to have completely blended into the crowd. It's a brilliant one-take bit of emotional storytelling. Now, I'm just going to jump around this story a bit because there's mainly two key points that I want to make, but I need to present the context first. So Mickey tries to visit his still alive grandmother, only to get mistaken for his alternative self, Ricky, who is part of the Preachers, who want to take down Cybus Industries. Noel Clark plays Ricky, Andrew Hayden Smith plays Jake, and Helen Griffin plays Mrs. Moore. They're following the paper trail that links Cybus Industries to kidnapping homeless people off the streets and using them for experiments. Also, there's a great reference to the 1968 story The Invasion, where the dummy company with the vans is called International Electromatics. This group converges with the Doctor and Rose at Jackie Tyler's 39th birthday party when John Lumick assassinates the President of Great Britain and kidnaps all of the people at the party to be converted. But our heroes do escape, except for Ricky, who gets killed, and they all plan to take down Cybus Industries from the inside. The Doctor and Mrs. Moore sneak in underground but get kidnapped and confront a converted John Lumick, who is now the Cyber Controller. Pete and Rose are unsuccessful in saving Jackie and are also taken to Lumick, while Mickey and Jake manage to take down the transmitter. Now, problem number one, only one of these three narrative strands actually adds up to anything, meaning that the Age of Steel, the second part, doesn't have a lot of momentum to it. It really does just feel like the Doctor, Mrs. Moore, Pete and Rose are just wandering around without anything in the way of tangible gain. Now, obviously, we discover what happens to Jackie, and the Doctor also discovers the emotional inhibitor is the weakness, essentially giving the Doctor a big red button to press to win. The Doctor is given a 7-digit code which destroys all of the Cybermen. However, that 7-digit code cop-out does not feel cheap. Why is that? Well, for one reason, and it's the one thing that makes Rise of the Cybermen and the Age of Steel stand out beyond it being a Cyberman story. Mickey Smith. Mickey is the one to give the Doctor the code. When the deus in your deus ex machina is Mickey in this story, it feels effective, and this has been set up very effectively from the beginning, where Mickey is separated from the Doctor and Rose. Firstly, Mickey knows full well that the Doctor will not run after him, but will instead go for Rose. Not only does this make Mickey feel like a more independent character, due to his knowledge and self-awareness of this dynamic as the Tin Dog, but this narrative sleight of hand means that while the Doctor and Rose are able to see how the other half live at the Tyler party, Mickey gets a view from the ground level. This, believe it or not, is in my opinion the most important scene of the story.
Am I right to get boss?
Yeah. No bother. Curfew doesn't start till 10.
There's a curfew?
Of course there is. Where you been living, mate? Up there with the tops.
I wish. See ya.
This isn't important necessarily because of the information being given, but because of Mickey's place in this story, where he gets to see how the average person lives. Going back very briefly to spare parts, that audio adventure is significantly less effective if you don't have the Hartley family in the middle of it. That story loses its emotional anchor point, and in this subplot, Mickey learns of the curfew imposed on the citizens, joins with the preachers, and maybe most importantly, meets his grandmother, who immediately upon opening the door thinks that someone is either trying to rob her or that she might be taken away, which says a hell of a lot about the state of mind of the average citizen. And this scene gives me a lump in my throat every time. Noel Clark is outstanding here.
Who is it? I know you're there. Shame on you tricking an old lady. I've got nothing worth stealing, and don't think I'm gonna disappear. You're not gonna take me. Is that you?
It's me. I came home.
Ricky?
It's Mickey.
I know my own grandson's name. It's Ricky. Now come here.
Okay, I'm Ricky. Of course I am Ricky. That's me.
You stupid boy.
Ow!
Where have you been?
Stop hitting me!
It's been days and days. I keep hearing all these stories, people disappearing off the streets. There's nothing official on the download, but there are all these rumors and whispers. I thought they'd gone and disappeared you.
That carpet on the stairs, I told you to get it fixed. You're gonna fall and break your neck.
Well, you get it fixed for me.
I should have done way back. I guess I'm just kind of useless.
Now, I never said that.
I am, though. And I'm sorry, Gran, I'm so sorry.
Don't talk like that.
And when Ricky comes into the picture, while he may talk a big game, Ricky isn't even that big of a deal in his own universe. He wears the badge of London's Most Wanted, but it turns out it's just for parking tickets. But he has a boldness and a confidence that Mickey admires and starts adapting to over the course of the two-parter, though I will never quite understand why Ricky interrogates Mickey in just his underwear. You can even pinpoint the second this change occurs, when Ricky is chased down and killed by the Cybermen when trying to climb over a metal chain fence, and once he's caught... God, that scene is creepy, and it's such a great distillation of what makes the Cybermen different from so many other monologuing and shouting villains. So Mickey tries to step up and help Jake, while also trying to be a positive influence by convincing him to not kill the human guards protecting the Zeppelin above the factory, making sure the Doctor and Rose and Pete don't get left behind, and also, one of the key moments, actually goading a Cyberman into attacking him, tricking it into destroying the transmitter control.
Hey, Cyberman, over here! Come on, you brain, let's stand with help. Come and have a go!
And once the day is saved, Mickey decides to stay behind to take down the other cyber factories across the world with Jake. And I love this goodbye, with Rose realizing how she took Mickey for granted and the two summarizing the situation perfectly.
We've had a laugh though, haven't we? Seen it all, been there and back. Who would have thought me and you off the old estate, flying through the stars?
All these years just sitting there, imagining what we'd do one day. We never saw this, did we?
The two, in their own ways, have outgrown each other, from the council estate to time and space, and I love how at the end, the story does take a moment for Rose to come back home to take stock and to hug her mum again. Okay, so now it's time for me to pay up and to talk about and explain all those aspects that I've pushed further back into this review. I wanted to front load this video with the really positive and strong aspects, mainly for the sake of review structure and to make sure that I'm not going back and forth everywhere. Because while I think the inclusion of this parallel world really works for Mickey's character arc in giving us a brand new version of the Cybermen, its benefits in this singular story seem to begin and end there, because it also gives us a whole new political ecosystem and set of characters who need developing, and this story doesn't really do much to give us that. Like Jake. Now, there's a deleted scene at the end of the episode where it's kind of played off as a joke that him and Ricky were boyfriends.
I know it's not easy with my face looking exactly like Ricky, but I'm a different man, I'm not replacing him.
He never could. I'll never have another boyfriend like him.
Okay, definitely not replacing him.
However, wouldn't it have been like 1,000 times more effective to establish that a bit earlier on, so that this scene...
He tried, he was running. There was too many of them.
Shut it.
There was nothing I could do.
I said just shut it. Don't even talk about them. You're nothing, you are. Nothing.
Can hit significantly harder. We also have characters like Mrs. Moore, who seem like she would be really great companion material, but ideally, you'd have more for her to do in this story. The moment she starts reeling off backstory in the tunnels, you can tell that she's destined for death, her number's up. Now, I know it's a massive rabbit hole that the story wisely chooses to ignore, but bear with me. In this parallel world, what is the system that has allowed this single company to control so much of the population? I only ask this because Rise of the Cybermen and the Age of Steel has one massive, gaping plot hole in the center of it, and it's a question that, once asked, you cannot remove yourself from. So, I'm giving you folks the rare opportunity to back out now if you don't want me to permanently spoil this story for you. Okay, you ready? 3, 2, 1. Why does John Lumick want to convert the population? Now yeah, he's insane, and while Roger Lloyd Pack is going over the top, I remember his performance getting quite a lot of flack in 2006, but looking back from the perspective of the wasteland that is 2020, Lumick's obvious insanity looks positively quaint.
I shall have to inform them.
And how will you do that from beyond the grave?
Yeah, he's obviously insane behind closed doors, but I've seen politicians and pretend tech geniuses actually talk and act like this in real life. Look at Elon Musk's Twitter feed sometime, or rather don't. Now, Lumick wanting to convert himself in order to gain immortality and save his frail and dying body, that makes sense, absolutely. But why does he want to enforce that on everyone else? He already has incredible political influence. It can't be for monetary benefits because he's not charging these people for the conversion, and he doesn't even need to do it by force because he has the earpieces. Like, why did he crash Tyler's party if he was just going to brainwash the survivors anyway?
But he's overreached himself. He's still just a businessman. He's assassinated the president.
Holy shit, he did do that. He did do that. He assassinated the president of Great Britain. What is Lumick's rationale for that? Like, the president is wearing earpods. Why didn't he just try to brainwash him into giving public speeches saying, yes, John Lumick's conversion is completely fine and everyone should do it? Like, why did he kill him?
And if I refuse?
Don't.
What happens if I refuse?
I'm telling you, don't.
What happens if I refuse, Harry?
I'm telling you, don't.
Okay, fair enough.
This issue is further compounded when you consider the perspective of his friend and colleague, Mr. Crane, played by Colin Spall, who you may remember from Revelation of the Daleks. So Mr. Crane is absolutely okay with kidnapping homeless people, going on recruitment drives, quote-unquote, toying with the homeless people to make them obey his instructions. He's positively flippant about the process and the horrible things he's doing.
They've grafted on a treat, these have. Given a little persuasion, if you care to observe, sir. And turn to the right. And back to the left.
Are you having fun, Mr. Crane?
No, not at all, sir. No, it's just, well, it's irresistible.
And even lightly dances to music when they're being converted and tortured.
Whoa. Let's cover up that noise. Give us track number 90.
However, once the plan is in action in the Age of Steel, his earpods try to brainwash him. Okay, why did he even have them in the first place? He knows what's going to happen. Then his next and final scene is him tricking Lumic into letting him get close so he can try and destroy his life support system. Like, what was the issue he had here? Crane was not only an accomplice, but a willing one, until he just wasn't anymore. Basically, Lumic just wants to turn everyone into Cybermen because the story mandated Cybermen, and he also needed to become the controller so we can do a hierarchy callback to the classic series. And you want to know the most frustrating thing here? With just some slight adjusting to the story, you can have Lumic still work in the story and have it make sense. So, let's do a rewrite. Lumic wants to become a Cyberman to give him eternal life, but he needs test subjects, so him and Mr. Crane steal homeless people right off the street and convert them. The first groups go wrong, but after some fine-tuning and adjustments, he perfects the conversion process. Great stuff. Lumic will now do it to himself. However, the Cybermen he's already converted, they've got other plans. They do not want to stop at just Lumic. They are fully logical now. They think about all the pain they no longer feel and want everyone else to be free of those restraints. So, those Cybermen, they take control of Cybus Industries, the rejects, the dispossessed, the abused and stolen. They take over, and now the Doctor and the Preachers aren't fighting Lumic anymore, they're fighting the system. A system with such a warped sense of morality in the face of logic that they deify their creator as the controller. Change the dynamic around so the Cybermen themselves become the main villain instead of Lumic, and this singularity, this black hole of a plot hole, this black hole of an issue, goes away in an instant. And this is why I think the story feels so sluggish in its second part, The Age of Steel, and why it lacks the emotional heft and potential from Rise of the Cybermen, because we don't actually know what and why. Like, Lumic's plan is just convert everyone into Cybermen, and that's literally all the audience are given. It means that when the 10th Doctor is trying to negotiate and reason with Lumic towards the end, it just doesn't resonate, because the Doctor is arguing against a position that's not tenable, and the audience don't have a frame of reference for. Now, notice how I say frame of reference, because Lumic doesn't necessarily need a good motivation or a good plan, he just needs something. And in this story, it does everything around it a disservice because he doesn't have that something. For example, the Doctor and Mrs. Moore, they use the cooling tunnels underground to get into the main base, but they find that the corridors are full of Cybermen. This episode uses this moment as a jump scare because, look how many Cybermen there are. However, I'd argue that a better moment in this story would be, how many homeless and missing people did Lumic convert? That's the missing element of the story. And I'm not trying to bash this two-parter, because I do like it. It's a testament to its sums that the whole of its parts is able to be elevated by them. Like Graham Harper's incredible, bold, and dynamic direction, the Cybermen's new design and screen presence, Noel Clarke's performance, Murray Gold's music, which doesn't feel like a retread of the Daleks' theme, but it gives the Cybermen their own distinct flavour. However, it's the world-building which lets the side down drastically. And you may say that's unfair, but we're in a parallel world. World building is the bedrock to a story like this, fundamentally, by design. and while some of the emotional and character beats are continued on in Doomsday, this lack of clarity and world-building makes its way there too.
So we sealed them inside the factories.
Except people argued, said they were living. We should help them.
This feels like it needs its own spin-off to justify. Like, I would genuinely love to see a three-part Big Finish drama called Pete's World, starring Sean Dingwall, Noel Clarke, Andrew Hayden Smith, and Penelope Walton as Harriet Jones, depicting this, because this scene is so vague, but its subtext is so politically loaded that it begs for explanation. Unfortunately, because of the mandates and the requirements to set up Army of Ghosts and Doomsday, it means that Rise of the Cybermen and the Age of Steel falters as a result. It's still enjoyable in parts as a 90-minute big-budget TV story, but honestly, it could and should have told a much richer story in a more dynamic world with much more well-defined characters. This story had the capacity to be a 10, but instead is coasting along at a 6. And while that's not bad, it is disappointing. Now, the Cybermen do return in Series 2, but I covered that story last year on Dialexember. Quite fitting, really, because the Cybermen do basically get shafted by the Daleks in that story in every single way. But believe it or not, we do have another follow-up story that we can talk about in its place. Ladies and gentlemen, for one day only, we're leaving London, and I'm taking you to Cardiff. Because tomorrow, on Cybercember, we're leaving the world of Doctor Who, and going where only the grown-ups belong. I'll see you folks then for Cybercember After Dark.
I'm you.